Hello, I'm Helen Van Wyk, and welcome to my studio. I'm sure you've all heard that green and red are complementary to each other. And it's because green is a secondary color. It's the mixture of yellow and blue, and then yellow and blue plus red become the three primary colors, and it's all very confusing. And what does it really have to do with painting? I want to show you. It's going to be color mixing in action and focusing just on red and green. And so I've set up these peppers as a stand-in for this picture. And so there's the envelope that I usually use to find out, to make sure that I'm using as much canvas as I would like, not making it too small or too big. And I'm not going to even torture myself with the drawing right now. I would rather just decide how much space each element is taking up. So now, added to these little indications, I can move in and make some extra shapes to indicate their drawing. One of the things that I have to be aware of is perspective, because these long, skinny peppers are sitting in positions that disguise the shape that we recognize them always to be. This one's foreshortened. This one here, this pepper, is long, but this one's facing me, and so I have to foreshorten it. Perspective. That element of drawing that changes the shapes because we see these things flop down in depth, and we have to put them on this surface. So we try to plop the subject down on this canvas. It seems to take up the space enough. And now, painting is a battle. I'm going to have to battle out how to accomplish it from this point. From this point on, well, I have red and green and the background color. What do you think would be easier? I really think I should put the background color in first, and always ask me why. Why am I going to put the background color in first? Because it's the more fragile color. If I put the red and green in and then put the white in, the white might bleed the red into the white and the green into the white. So I think it would be easier to put the white in first. Always trying to make it easy. And you can find the easy way too. If you're not afraid, if you're not afraid of making mistakes. And so, let me just fill this in. One of the ways to make sure you get an adequate coverage is to choose the right brush. The right brush. I've chosen one that's substantial and big. Big jobs, big brushes. Little jobs, little brushes. That seems practical enough. But I will say that we get a much better coverage with a brush if you make the strokes no longer than an inch and a half. You never see me do this. It really doesn't work. Putting it on in strokes like this and then moving it, you have a little bit of the dampness that your brush is near to help it spread. But one of the things I think that many of you who watch me don't pick up on is you don't realize how many times I go back to the palette to replenish my brush. Because I do it so fast, I will have this color overlapped. I'm overlapping the color into these peppers so that when I do the peppers, I can have the colors meet. Maybe I'd like to try another substantial brush to lay in the basic color of the peppers. Well, I have three wants, three colors, the red, the light green, and this dark green. Why don't I use some of that dampness right here? I took phthalo yellow green and I put it here. I'm going to put it down. There's nothing wrong with that color. It's the color that I would put next to it that is the important decision. We make our colors react to each other. And I just feel as though that's a closer one to the way my eye sees it and a little safer. It's darker in contrast to the white, off-white background. I thought it looked better in relation to the color that I put there, put it on the background. And now I see the light is coming from the right as usual, and now I see the green getting darker and duller, and that's when I have to use red. Why? Because that's the dictate of nature. The complementary color diminishes, adding the complementary color into a color diminishes its intensity. Well, if this is shadowed, that means that the intensity of the light is being diminished. Why don't I come right on over to this one and paint this one in? I find a lot of people at this stage do it very messy and say, oh well, fiddly-dee, I'll fix it later. No, right now you have to be a little bit, you have to be quite careful about the coverage, the basic color, and the shape of each one. So I've done this one, I've done this one, I've got this and this and this and this to do. Let's paint that pepper. The red one, the expensive one. I'm going to take a gob. And let's try that out. Actually, that's pretty close, just the way it is. Some people say you can never use a color right out of the tube. Why not? If it works, use it. If you think it looks all right, I'll show you how carefully I really paint. I'm working on one of its lumps. The lump that seems to be forming that outline. I fill in the paint according to the object's structure or anatomy. Hoping that the brushstroke then accidentally makes some found and lost lines, sharp edges and fuzzy edges, rather than all looking as though it's just pasted on. Well, why fill this in, right in here? That's the shadow side. So why don't I concentrate this color where I know the light hits? And now let's see what green, the color's complement, can do to dimensionalize this pepper. First, I've darkened the red. Importante to do that. And then the green. If you just put green in it, it's not really as looks as right. First, you have to darken the color and then add the complement. Oh, I tell you all my secrets. This is in shadow plus in cast shadow. In cast shadow from the stem. Now those are the planes. Those are the areas that I absolutely know are turning away from the light. I do see a dark over here, but I would never put it there. Never put a dark on the side that's toward the light. Why? Always ask me why, because that makes a muddy little spot. Instead, I'll turn that dark by making this lighter. By now, taking white with this red. Because where there's light, there's white. White is the artist's substitute for light. Now, this may not look like the color you see. It doesn't look like the color I see either, but it's the color I need to present the dimension and the luminosity that I'm aware of. So we are not enslaved by what's there, because this picture already has its own personality. It's beginning to have its own personality, and I have to serve it. And I see that brighter red, especially hitting this bump. This has a somewhat poster-like quality. It stands out. You know why it stands out? Because none of the rest of them are done. Your eye is focused on that. Before I continue and finish it, I'd like to see how the supporting members are going to help the pictorial effect. So it's this pepper. That one's a little darker. So into this red, I'm adding alizarin to make it a darker red to begin with. Because of variety, too. I don't want them to be exactly alike. We like variety. And again, why put that color, this body tone color, as I always refer to an object's true color, why put that where I know I'm going to put a shadow? Why don't I leave that vacant so I can then fill in and here darken it again, darker, more alizarin, plus sap green. Maybe I need phthalo green in this one to make a stronger dark, a darker green to make a darker shadow. Ah. Very often I've seen students put this on and say, oh God, I can't do that, because they don't give it a chance. Right now it doesn't look right, but it might do the job once it's completed the job of putting in all the shadows. I think that many students are apt to be too critical per moment. You don't do that. You can't paint which is positive and creative and criticize which is negative at the same time. So spend time to actually do it to a certain stage and then judge the whole stage or this whole stage of development rather than per stroke. Because now that dark color doesn't look so bad. Looks all right to me. And I'm not going to brighten that one as much. Well, it's not as light to start with, so maybe I'll just add it a little lighter here, where I know that the light is hitting it very hard. I'm painting a la prima. A la prima means all at once. I did start on a toned canvas, which makes a la prima easier. I haven't done an underpainting. I haven't done anything to do a complicated or... I don't have a complicated subject, who says? Every subject has its complications. And if you recognize it, then you win the battle. But if you say, oh, poopsie-doo, it's easy, you're not maybe going... It's going to win rather than you win. And now I'm putting more green into this red because I want to use the red into green for the cast shadow that this is causing on this pepper over here. And why don't I put this in shadow too? And why don't I put that over here? And let me, this is a stage I'd like to get this dark, lose that. Remember I said that painting is a battle? Yes, we battle our color mixtures, we battle, oh, a lot of things, but the biggest battle seems to be between the background and the subject. We try to make the subject win. And one way to make the subject win is to always do your background in relation to the subject, to make it look better. And so I'm going to add more light around the subject to make it stand out. I did complete this massing in of the colors of the subject before I got to this stage. Of course, I had to finish one stage before I go on to another. It makes working in steps or stages makes your picture have a sensible, consistent presentation, paint presentation, color presentation. People worry about color mixtures. Their color mixtures have to be color mixtures, mixtures in action, because if they don't act in relation to the way the picture's been put together. So some say, oh, gee, that color looks so right. Well, it looks all right because it's been applied correctly. It's been applied with a brushstroke that's exciting. It's been applied with a brushstroke that's thick enough. So that's the brush you use. Now I'd like to show you another place where the complementary color has to be employed, and that is in moving the background's effect into the subject. And because these peppers have a shiny texture, there is reflections coming from the white cloth. So I'm taking the white cloth color, darkening it with black, and adding green into that color for the reflections on the red. Because I want those reflections to look gray. So green gray on red will turn gray, I hope. And these reflections make the subject enjoy their background situation. So gray-green on red for any time you see a shine. Whether the shine is a reflection, such as these, lighter things, or highlights. They would be lighter greens, white and green. I'm sure you can see that that's green, and it's going to look white when it gets on here. Well, maybe made it too dark. Here, here, replenish the brush, here, bumps and dents. I'm in the bumps and dent business today. And a beautiful highlight here, spreading across this place that's right in line with the light. And on the green, on this green one, it looks just like a dumb blob. I know how I can make it look a little bit better. I'm going to quick put a little there. That was fun. I'm going to quickly put in reflections. Now they're going to be gray red. Oh, I told you this was stop and go. We're either going with red or stopping with red or going with green or whatever. But color mixing is not that difficult. If you really believe in color and complement. It's simple. Ho ho. Well, look what that's done to that. Well, I wonder what kind of a recipe I can make with these peppers. It better be good after how much I paid for them. So next time we meet, I'll teach you something else. And in the meantime, I'm going to make pepper soup.